Well done, yeah?
Good.
Well, this would, you know, by count, be the first week of Advent, going into Christmas. But I'm not going to preach a Christmas message just yet. We're gonna finish up the book of Hebrews today, so that when, you know, Lord willing, Aragon's here next week, he can launch us into the Christmas season with the sermon then. So if you have your Bible, if you open up to Hebrews chapter 13, I'll meet you there. Now, I'm not going to do what I've famous or infamously done and chronicle the whole, you know, book of Hebrews, but I will just say that one of the major themes in Hebrews, as I mentioned last week, is the constant call of the author to the audience to endure and to persevere and to carry on, and not to hang on by a thread, not to barely make it, not to do, you know, not to just, you know, slide into home, you know, and barely make it. No, he wants them to return to the same kind of confidence that they had at the first. He wants them to maintain the same type of sacrificial love, the excitement, the enthusiasm, the zeal that they had when they very first heard the message and believed and were saved from their sins. He wants them to finish strong. And so that's really the purpose of this book. Now, there's lots of themes throughout the book and explanations, and there's rich theology and so on. But the purpose of this author, who we don't know who he is, writing to this audience is that some of them, it sounds like their soul was even in peril because of the way they were flirting with another religion, basically. And he couldn't stand for it. He was just worked up about their persistence in the faith. And so I just mentioned that to remind us that when we get to the chapter 13 and we see all these commands about loving the brothers and don't be, you know, be content, don't be given to the love of money, like we talked about last week, and these type of commands, we can't see these as like an addendum that was just added later, or as like a, oh, by the way, while I'm writing a letter to you, I'll just throw a couple things in here. This is in line and in context of him telling them to persevere and to continue. And like I mentioned last week, the continuance in the faith is not just holding on to the doctrine that you were given and saying that you believe that, and then you know, not disagreeing with that. It is to remain in the doctrine, but it also is to remain in the practice. And so these commands, as I mentioned last week, are not new commands. These are, not only are they not new because they're not really that clever or anything, it's almost kind of common sense for you know, Christianly speaking, but they're not new in the sense that he even refers back to times earlier in the book when they've done these things. And so I used some of those examples last week when it came to brotherly love and showing hospitality and so forth. But this week, as we look at verses 7 through the end of the book, we need to remember, as I've spent the last couple minutes just refreshing our memory, that this is a group of believers that have been believing for a while, have suffered some things, have stood fast, at least for a while, but now they're starting to turn away. And so this is, as we're going to see at the end of this chapter, the very end of the book, he calls this an exhortation. And he refers to the whole unit, the whole letter as a whole, as an exhortation to these believers, that they would stay the course and hold fast. So, if you'll stand with me, we'll read from verse 7 all the way down to the end, and then we will slow down and take it one by one. This is God's word. Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings. It is good for our hearers to be strengthened by grace, not by eating ceremonial foods, which is of no benefit to those who do so. We have an altar from which those who minister at the tabernacle have no right to eat. The high priest carries the blood of animals into the most holy place as a sin offering, but the bodies are burnt outside the camp. And so Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his own blood. Verse 13. Let us then go to him outside the camp, bearing the disgrace he bore. For here we do not have an enduring city, but we are looking for the city that is to come. Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly profess his name. And do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices God is pleased. Have confidence in your leaders and submit to their authority, because they keep watch over you as those who must give an account. Do this so that their work will be a joy, not a burden, for that would be of no benefit to you. Pray for us. We are sure that we have a clear conscience and desire to live honorably in every way. I particularly urge you to pray so that I may be restored to you soon. Verse 20. Now, may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I urge you to bear with my word of exhortation, for in fact I have written to you quite briefly. I want you to know that our brother Timothy has been released. If he arrives soon, I will come with him to see you. Greet all your leaders and all the Lord's people. Those from Italy send you their greetings. Grace be with you all. Father, would you bless your word to us and give us ears to hear and eyes to see the truth, in Jesus' name. Amen. Be seated. Like I said, I'm going to attempt to work my way all the way through this passage. You could easily break this up into, I think, about three or four different sections. But I'm not going to do that. I'm going to try to just finish this out today so that we can go into the Christmas season and coming out of that start a new series. And so I just titled this sermon today, Final Words, because these are the final words of the author, obviously. If I was to, as I took all this, one of the most difficult things about sermon prep is just to outline the passage, because, you want to not neglect the flow of thought that came previously to the passage you're preaching, but you also want to connect it to what's coming after, and then outline it in a way that it's easy to follow as a sermon. And so the outline I came up with today was to just see that we are called to persevere with Jesus, number one, and to persevere under leadership. Now, if you look at the first couple verses, verses 7 and 8, I think there's just kind of four aspects to my point here of persevering with Jesus. Number one is persevere with Jesus like our predecessors, like those who have come before us. Number two, we persevere with Jesus in our doctrine. Number three, we persevere with Jesus, whatever the cost. And number four, we persevere with Jesus with continual thanks and generosity. And we'll take those one by one. So we persevere with Jesus like our predecessors, like those who have come before us. We picked it up in verse 7. He says, remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. The most obvious point to make here, first of all, is that persistent faith in God's promises has been done before. We are not the first generation who has been given the word of God and then asked to believe it, or commanded to believe it, and then commanded to continue in that for the duration of our life. This is not new. That expectation of a lifelong submission and commitment to the Lord is not new. But since it's not new, the author here points these people back to consider those that have come before them in order to draw strength from their example. When it says here that to consider their outcome of their way of life, like in the NIV, or if I know we have some King James Bible readers here. In the King James, it says the end of their conversation. I just gotta say, it's stuff like that makes me thankful for other translations. King James is cool, but it's more understandable, I think, in these other translations. But what this is really getting at is it means their end and their exit. It's talking about their death, the end of their life, and the termination of their life. He's telling them to, first of all, remember that you are just the next one in line to grab the baton in this relay race, and you're going to hand it off to somebody else also. And so consider those that have come before you and the kind of race that they ran. Think back to them. There's a really good place for reading the biographies of saints before us, of people who were martyrs, or reading about the stand that they took or the difficulties that they went through toward the end of their life, or even people that were, you know, people like John MacArthur one day. People will look at John MacArthur one day and see not only, you know, some of the battles that he's won or been engaged in throughout his ministry, but just the sheer length of his ministry. 50 plus years in the same church, being criticized by groups of people, outlasting and outliving them in most cases. But there are scores of quote unquote John MacArthur's before us already that we could be considering. Now, in the context of this audience, this would be likely, it's not definite, but it'd likely be the apostles. It was those who brought the word of God forth. It was those who were breaking away from Judaism, maybe, which is, we're going to see that in a minute, that's what this group was tempted to go back to. But it was people like Paul who broke away from Judaism, who was a ranking official, basically, in that religion, who now have been given the most current and full revelation of Word of God and handed that down and spent the rest of his life marching around, you know, in places of opposition, places of friendliness, wherever he was, sharing this message. And he's telling this, or the author here is telling this audience to consider men like that, and specifically the end of their life and how they died, how they finished strong. Because his theme here, remember, his purpose is to get this congregation to finish strong. And there are people that have finished strong. Now, they may be the minority compared to people who start strong and don't finish strong, but all the more reason to consider those who did, you know, run through the finish line and not stumble or just, you know, barely fall on their face when they got there, but they finished strong. We're to consider those people, and we're specifically to consider the way that in which they went out. This is the same point and the same kind of consideration that he was getting at back in chapter 11. Remember in chapter 11, the Hall of Faith? Now, as much as I want to just stay here in this passage, I can't separate this from the rest of the letter. And so he's already made this point once, and he's just circling back to it at this point. Because in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 and 2, and it's probably on the same page or just a page back if you want to look at it, he is, again, exhorting them to faithfulness and perseverance. But then he makes the point that there are people who do not shrink back, but believe all the way until the end. And that's what he says at the end of chapter 10, going into chapter 11, when he says, chapter 10, verse 38, he's quoting Habakkuk. He says, "And my righteous one will live by faith, and I take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back." Now that's him quoting Habakkuk, and it's God speaking in Habakkuk there, saying that that God doesn't take pleasure in those who half-heartedly believe, or they believe for a while, but then because of their faint-heartedness, they just collapse and give up. No, he takes pleasure in those who live by faith. And he takes pleasure in those, it says, who don't shrink back. And so then the author, taking that encouragement, applies that to this church in verse 39 of chapter 10, where he says, "But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved." That's the launch pad from which he goes into chapter 11 and gives the example of those people who were faithful, who had faith to the uttermost, all the way to the end. And so, while through chapter 11, the specific point is what faith is and how we are to live by faith, there's examples of those who, by faith, were able to conquer things or were able to succeed. You remember, like, the phrase, they closed the mouth of lions, or they, you know, women received their dead back from, or their kids back from the dead, and things like that. So there are miracles and positive things that happen. But for our purpose today, and making the point that he's making in chapter 13, I want to just highlight the examples he used of those who, by faith, finished their race, even when it ended in, not glamorously. So in verse 1 and 2 of chapter 11 says, now faith is the confidence, there's that word again, confidence, in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for those who maintain their faith consistently, committed all the way to the end. And in verse 13, if you just skip down a little, it says this. All these people, now these people at this point, I'm not going to read all the examples, but it includes Abel, and you can just, if you know your Bible, you recognize these names. He's talked about Abel, by the time he gets to verse 13, he's talked about Enoch, he's talked about Noah, he's talked about Abraham, he's talked about Isaac, and he's talked about Jacob. So when he says verse 13, when he says all these people, those are who he's referring to, and this is what he says. Verse 13, all these people were still living by faith when they died. That's the point that he's getting at in chapter 13 now. Just like all these lists of people that we would continue to believe just as steadfastly as we did at the beginning of our conversion, even at our deaths, just like these people did. All these people were still living by faith when they died. Now, if you just fast forward a little bit from 32 to 39, we'll finish up this point. At the end of chapter 11, verse 32, after he's given kind of, small snippets and examples or explanations of examples of people who walk by faith, then he just goes on this litany, this whole list of people. He says, what more shall I say? I don't have time, and I don't have time either today. I don't have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Verse 35, women received back their dead, raised to life again. So there's the list of, like I said, a lot of successful things that happen as these people walk by faith. But then he gets into those who ended their life by walking in faith, but having their life cut short. It says, at the second part of verse 35, there were others, and it's these others that we're focused on today, who were tortured, refusing to be released so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes in the ground. These, including all those who shut the mouths of lions and all successful, but also these others that I'm highlighting, all of these were commended for their faith, yet none of them had received what had been promised. It's these type of examples that the writer is pointing us to consider in chapter 13. Those who, even at the end of their life, after they've suffered who knows what, and in on top of just the daily woes and the consistent ebbs and flows of life and the confusion that comes with that, on top of all of that, had these extreme difficulties that came to their life specifically because they were Christian. Now, there's some things in life that you can avoid. There's some pains you can avoid. If my kids would just listen to me, and everybody agrees, you can say amen to that. If your kids would just listen to you, there's some pains they could avoid.
Amen.
One of the pains that you could avoid also is the insults and mistreatments and jail time, if it comes to that, that's associated with being a Christian. That's an optional pain. Cancer is not quite an optional pain. Lupus is not quite an optional pain. There's lots of pains that are not optional. One that is optional is the persecution and suffering and loss and difficulty that comes from being a Christian. So why would you opt into that? Why would you remain in a painful situation when all you have to do is flip the switch? Just compromise. Just back out. Just deny it. Just for a second. And then God will forgive you later. It's a wicked way of thinking. I'll just highlight one of these again. We already read it, but I'm just going to say it one more time. It says in verse 35 that they refused to be released from prison. That highlights the optionality of this. You know why? Because you know that the God that you, that saved you is the God who's going to sustain you, and the God that you're looking forward to seeing and hearing, well done, good and faithful servant. It's the confident faith that you maintain on that last day. That's what I'm interested in, and every person in this church's relationship with God, is that on the last day, in the last days, your last days, that you're going to be holding on just as tight, clinging to Jesus just as tight as you ever did. That's what the author is getting at here in chapter 13 when he tells them, remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you, consider the outcome of their way of life, and imitate their faith. When you remember that kind of strong conviction that they had, that these martyrs had, that these people had, walking through life for so many years, relying on the Lord, imitate that. In a world full of self-promotion and people trying to get followers and likes and subscribers, why don't you subscribe to that? We have these heroes in the faith to look back at and gain strength from and follow the example of. In addition to the lineage of the faithful that I just mentioned in Hebrews 11, there were those who spoke the word of God to them specifically. That's who he's referring to. So while you have Abraham, Isaac, those that lived thousands of years before, he's talking about those current people that were even maybe contemporaries of these folks. He mentioned mentions those also in chapter 2, verse 3, when he says that this salvation, which was first announced by the Lord, was confirmed to us by those who heard him. So there was, again, just a group of people that were more contemporary to these folks who were listening to this letter that the writer is reminding them of. The word of God that is being referred to, because he said it's those who spoke the word of God, that word of God is the word of God that's concerning Jesus, who is the Christ. It's the Jesus who is the Christ. That's the central message of the gospel, is the identity, is the person and work of Jesus. That he is the Lord, hence the phrase Jesus is Lord. And that he has come on a mission. He was sent by God. That's what the idea of the Messiah is, the one who was anointed by God for a mission, the Christ. What this audience is being exhorted to hold fast to is that message, and then the lifestyle that follows from it. And so they need to remember not only the faith, like the actions of those who brought the message to them, but also the message that they brought, not just their lifestyle and their consistency, but the message that they brought, which is centered on who Jesus is. Which brings us to our next point, which is that we are to persevere with Jesus like our predecessors did, and we're also to persevere with Jesus in our doctrine. Jesus Christ, if it says in verse 8, is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I meant to rope this in with the first point, and I didn't really do so too much, but This verse works as a transition from verse 7 to verse 9. In verse 7, you have the word of God that was preached, which is all centered on Jesus. And so the people that came bearing this message to this audience, where was their faith placed in? The Lord Jesus Christ. And so the end of their life was characterized by their holding on to the message that was about Jesus. And so as the author is reminding them of the bearers of the truth that came and preached to them, they are to hold on to that same message. This is what they're to hold on to. I mean, it's not just a command to just be stubborn, just be resolute about something. It's to be resolute about your faith in the Lord Jesus. And we'll see by the end of this why that can be difficult, because of the specificity of Jesus. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever, meaning that he is faithful. The promises that he's given are faithful. They're the same. They're not going to change. Let me say this. Nothing including the time that we live in, the temptations that we face, the type of opposition that we face, the length of time that we have to endure. I mean, in a sense, you could say that the thief on the cross had it made because he got saved and then just got to go and be in the presence of the Lord right away. But each of us has a different length of time that we have to endure on this earth. The societal structure that you're in, the loss that you've experienced, none of those things should shake you from the kind of confidence shared by those who trusted in the Christ who announced this great salvation and promised his return and promised his established kingdom and has made more and promised to never leave us and forsake us and has promised to vindicate us on the last day. Because those promises don't change. It's that kind of steadfastness and faithfulness and reliability of the Lord that fuels our steadfastness in believing in him and trusting in him. He is not like me to my kids where I have to, you know, I have to say everything with a maybe or we'll see because I just am not sure. Because if I say something, then things change and then, I just lose credibility and reliability. He's not that way. Jesus makes promises and they do not change. And because they do not change, you can fall into them wholeheartedly and rely upon them and make true the statement in Scripture, which is already true, but I'm just make true the statement that he who trusts in the Lord will not be disappointed. That's what Scripture says. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Meaning all those promises are exactly the same. They won't change. It's completely reliable and constant. Therefore, it garners our complete trust and reliance. But another aspect, because I said verse 8 is a transition to verse 7, which is how I just linked that to verse 7, but now I'm going to link it to verse 9. It's a transition into verse 9. Because in verse 9, it says, do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings. Now, Jesus Christ is the same in the promises that he gives and the assurance and the reliability of his character. But he's also the same in that he doesn't change, that the teaching about him is specific and is descriptive of him, and that doesn't change. Jesus Christ is the same person, and the doctrine of the faith, meaning the whole of the Christian doctrine, doesn't change. It needs to be a well-ordered theology that's robust and then handed down and handed down and handed down and handed down and treated with the utmost care as it's being handed down. Because there's nothing else to add. This is, we've got the final revelation. It's done. Canon's closed. Now all we need to do is not obscure it, not skip over things, not take things away, not distort it, not twist it, not abuse it, not apologize for it. We need to just go deeper and deeper into understanding who Jesus is as revealed through Scripture and as harvested out by theologians before us and cling to that. Do not be carried away, he says in verse 9, by all kinds of strange teachings. Let's stop there for a second. There are all kinds of strange teachings. It refers to those teachings that distort or undermine the person and work of Christ. That's what we're talking about. That's specifically what we're talking about by a strange teaching. Something that's gonna drag us away from the Lord Jesus Christ, because salvation is found in the Lord Jesus Christ. All of the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are found in the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything that we need for life and godliness is found in him. We need to beware and be on guard against teachings that are coming in to try to subvert or distract us away from our faith in him. And those teachings are myriad. There are all kinds of teachings. But there's one in particular here, of course, that the author has in mind. And so he goes on to say, if you look at the second part of verse 9, it is good for our hearts to be strengthened by grace, not by eating ceremonial foods, which is of no benefit to those who do so. Now, what does it mean for our hearts to be strengthened by grace? I think that the best way to understand that is to see what he contrasts it with. So he says, have your heart strengthened by grace rather than something else. And that's one way you can, like when scripture seems like it's unclear, it just kind of states something and you're not sure exactly what it's getting at. If there's a contrast, use the contrast in order to help inform the latter point. And so there is a contrast here, so let's look at it. It's good for our heart to be strengthened by grace, in contrast to, I'm just inserting that in order to get your attention, eating ceremonial foods, which is of no benefit to those who do so. Now, since it says ceremonial foods, this is not referring to all of the dietary restrictions in the Old Testament. Now, we know that those are abrogated, that we can eat what we want, but that's not the point that he's getting at here. He says ceremonial foods. Okay, so that's a little bit more specific. Skip down to verse 11. He says, the high priest carries the blood of animals into the most holy place as a sin offering, but the bodies are burned outside the camp. Now this gives us more understanding and more insight into exactly what type of foods he's talking about. He's called them ceremonial foods. Then he talks about the blood going into the most holy place. This is pop quiz time now, so if you're asleep, wake up. When is the priest going to go into the most holy place?
Once a year.
Once a year, on the Day of Atonement. So that's what he's referring to here. The high priest carries the blood of animals into the most holy place as a sin offering, but the bodies are burned outside the camp. Now this is from Leviticus chapter 16, 27. You can write it down if you want, because I don't have it on the screen. Leviticus chapter 16, verse 27. This is the detailing out of what the Day of Atonement is supposed to look like. And it says, but the bull of the sin offering and the goat of the sin offering, whose blood was brought in to make atonement in the holy place, shall be taken outside the camp, and they shall burn their hides, their flesh, and their refuse in the fire. That's what he's referring to here. Now, there were other offerings that were given in the tabernacle or the temple that the Levites, the priests, could eat from. So, and maybe I should have made those examples. I didn't think of it until right now, but there were some where, you know, you'd bring a bird or whatever type of animal it was, they would sacrifice it, and then the Levites would actually eat the flesh of that, and that was their food. It was like a gift from God, you know, and maybe even a principle there of eating from your labor, you know. But anyway, the fact is that there were some animals that they could eat from, but this one, the one that was, you know, the pinnacle of the year, every year, the sin of offering, the Day of Atonement, they couldn't eat from that one. And this is the one that we know doesn't ultimately take away sin, but it seemed like the chief example, the chief type of the atonement, the true atonement that would come in Jesus. He is, by in verse 10 here, sorry, verse 9, by in saying that it's good for our hearts to be strengthened by grace, not by the eating of some sort of ceremonial food, he is doing away with these sacrifices that people would make for their sins, as he's been doing through the whole book of Hebrews, over and over and over again. I mean, I'm the one who preached a sermon on the Levites going in and making all the sacrifices every day, and we walk through the day of the life of a priest. And he says that those things never do away with sin. They never take away sin. That's what's being alluded to here. That the strengthening of the heart, the true clear conscience that comes, is not by those sacrifices, but it's by grace. Now, where does the grace come from? Look at verse 10. We have an altar. So now he erects a counter to this other altar that he's referred to. You have the sin of offering on the Day of Atonement, and the animals, the flesh of the animals being pushed outside the camp as unclean or unfit. But he says, we have an altar. And it's not that one. From which those who minister at the tabernacle have no right to eat. Again, there is him, you know, putting his foot down, drawing a strict line, a bold line between service of the temple, service of the tabernacle, and worship of Jesus. He's because that is the temptation of this audience. They are tempted to go back to their prior religion and their prior religious system and look for salvation and pardon from their sin from that. He says, you can't do that. You either serve the tabernacle or you serve the Lord. They have a blood that's being spilled, but we have a blood that was spilled. And he says that in verse 12. And he says that Jesus made a people holy through his own blood. And it's for them, this teaching about the ceremonial foods and all that, that was the strange teaching that they were being tempted by. But I want you to note, for the purpose of applying this to our own life, that this was a religious temptation. Don't think that the only temptations that could cause you to wander away from the Lord are just secular temptations, or they're just doubts of what you believe here. There are other appeals from other religions that will seek to grab your attention, your affection, and your trust. Maybe, you know, so-and-so religion, they seem way more devout. They put a whole lot more into their religion. Maybe that's the true one. Maybe that's the real one. Not so. His interest is to point them to the man Christ Jesus, not even Judaism. Because we have an altar from which those, verse 10, who minister at the tabernacle have no right to eat. They don't have a right to eat at this altar if they're busy eating at that altar, because you participate with the altar that you eat at. 1 Corinthians 10. Now, as he's making this corollary or comparison or contrast between these two, the former altar and the new altar, he's using altar as a metonym. Metonym is when you point to something specific in order to refer to the whole. So, I could say, give me a hand. You know, you don't want the hand, but the hand's referring to my whole service, you know. He's using altar as a metonym, so it's really talking about the sacrifice of Jesus. That's what he's referring to when he says altar. And so anyway, as he's making this comparison, in verse 12, he says, okay, just like the flesh that's burned outside the camp, it's seen as unfit or as unclean. The blood was sprinkled on the altar and dealt with, but then you dispose of what's useless or what's not appropriate for services of worship here. It's that flesh that he identifies Jesus with, or compares Jesus with, in verse 12. And so Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his own blood. Let us then go to him outside the camp, bearing the disgrace he bore. See where I'm at with my notes. I may have got ahead of myself, as usual. Those who trust in the religious system and sacrifices of the tabernacle do not receive the benefits of the sacrifice of Christ. There is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. That's the point he's getting at. And any doctrine, any strange teaching that seeks to attack that or undermine that needs to be avoided. It needs to be avoided. Even if it promises salvation or something that Christ is lacking or something that you don't have in Christ, it's trying to add something. It's a strange teaching. It needs to be avoided. That's what he's getting at here. Again, not just secular temptations, other religious temptations. That's what their temptation was. So we need to be persevere with Jesus like our predecessors did. We need to persevere with Jesus also in our doctrine. And we need to persevere with Jesus whatever the cost. Verse 12, I'll read it again. And so Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his own blood. Then the call to action, verse 13. Let us then go to him outside the camp, bearing the disgrace that he bore. Remember that Jesus was liked by a whole bunch of people. Crowds of people. I mean, there happened to be 4,000 plus people there when it was dinner time and he fed them all. And 5,000 another time. He was liked by a lot of people. It's true. But don't forget that he was rejected. Don't forget that he was slandered, that he was falsely accused, and that nobody came to his aid out of all those 9,000 people I just mentioned, including the 12 people that were with him for 3 years, witnessed his miracles, were given power by him to go and cast out demons when they went two by two preaching the gospel, were provided for by him, were taught and instructed by him, were rebuked by him. They didn't come to his aid. Nor did the three within that 12 that were the most closest to him. The only three on the planet that watched him transfigure from a regular just human being to a bright radiant light, heard God the Father speaking with him, saw Elijah and Moses there at the same time. When it came right down to it, nowhere to be found. Even though Mr. Peter himself, the most zealous and most committed of them all, told him, I would never deny you until tonight. Three times maybe. But I promise after that I'll never do it again. Jesus was abandoned. Left for dead. Literally left for dead. Outside the camp, discarded, disposed of, cast out of the city, cast out of Jerusalem, out of the quarters of all of the Jewish people, cast out and killed out there. Death, and not only death, but death as that of a criminal. The writer of Hebrews is telling this persecuted group that used to associate with other people that were being mistreated, that used to go through the difficulty of living, you know, boldly in their faith. They got weary of that, or they just it was distasteful to them. And he's telling them, you go out and be discarded with the one who was discarded, our Lord Jesus. That our master, that we as servants of him are not greater than our master. And we are to bear that same reproach. We are to cling to him even when he's being disposed of by everyone, by any other religion who wants to minimize his significance, who wants to redefine his mission, who wants to... I have a person on my route that has told me three different times that, Mark, you're with me one time, actually. The lady that told me that Jesus never existed at all. There was no man named Jesus, that it was just a Roman myth, and she tries to get me to read this book or whatever. And I've been meaning to read the book and all that. I'm not, you know, you need to build bridges with people and talk to people. But the idea that Jesus didn't even exist, that's just another way of discarding him, of throwing shame on his name, of just kicking dirt over him. And he's calling them who have experienced some of that to go back there and remember in those difficult times who your Lord is and what he suffered. They chose a bona fide rebel. Everything they were accusing Jesus of, this guy was actually guilty of, Barabbas. They chose to release him into the public, let him go ahead and continue his insurrection and whatever kind of troublemaking he's going to do. Just don't let that man Jesus out. Cast him out of the city. Get rid of him. And the writer of Hebrews here is telling the Hebrews, that's your Lord. Go with him. Bear whatever reproach he bore. Fall in line. Fall in step with him. Isaiah 53:3 says this. It describes Jesus in this way. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. But 1 Peter 2:4 says this. Check this out. As you come to him, we're coming to him, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious. We cling to the stone that was rejected, but is actually the priceless pearl. He has a value that the world doesn't understand. And by world, I don't just mean the secular world, other religions, that they don't understand. He is of inestimable value. And we know that. And we're just trying to, the writer here and me to you is just trying to remind you of that, so that when clinging to him means letting go of others or being let go by others, cling to him tighter. Let's go. Next. With continual thanks and generosity. So we persevere with Jesus like his predecessors. We persevere with him in our doctrine. We persevere with him in whatever the cost. And now we persevere with him with continual thanks and generosity. Thankfulness begins with recognizing what you have been given. Look at verse 14. For here, we do not have an enduring city, but we are looking for the city that is to come. It even says earlier in Hebrews, just a few weeks ago, we actually mentioned this, that Jesus scorned the shame of the cross. This is, you can look, it's right there on the page right in front of you. It's in chapter 12, verse 2. It says, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith, for the joy set before him. Wait a minute. So kind of like verse 14 when it says we have an enduring city that's before us. We're looking forward to the city. There's a joy set before us in the same way there was a joy set before him. Okay, I'm going to read it again. Chapter 12, verse 2. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame. Listen, everything I just mentioned about Jesus being bearing reproach and being rejected and all that, I'm not glamorizing that. And I have to say that anybody that wants to say, you know, that we want persecution or something, that's wrongheaded. It's just wrongheaded. We are not, Christians are not gluttons for punishment that go around poking people in the eye and then running as fast as we can to see if we can get away. And I mean, that's not what we do. It's that the persecution and suffering is inevitable. It's inevitable, but you don't go around looking for it. So I'm not trying to glamorize that. But it does happen, and when it happens, how can we persevere in of all things, thankfulness. I mean, that's what the command is here. Well, you remember what you've been given and what is being given to you. Like it says in verse 14, the city that we're looking for. That's why in verse 15 it says explicitly, through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly profess his name. That's an important detail there. The fruit of the lips of those who profess his name, those who have trust in him, is continual praise. It's continual thankfulness. I don't know what you could take away from me or what could be taken away from you that would cause you to be ungrateful all of a sudden for everything God's already done in Christ Jesus for you. Will not him who has given his very son give you all things, Paul said to the Romans? So, when you suffer some measure of loss, we can still be reminded of everything we have been given and everything that we are promised in him. And that's what we're to cling to. That's what it means to cling to him. That's what the offer of praise is to him, is just a never-ending overflow of gratitude for what has been done for us in Christ by God the Father. And from that wellspring, that endless wellspring, that rivers of living water, given by the Spirit even, not only can we give praise, but we can do good to others. Verse 16, do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices God is pleased. Now, everything becomes a stewardship when you understand yourself as a foreigner with an allegiance elsewhere. Our allegiance is to the Lord. That's who we're seeking to please. We're caretakers, not homeowners. You understand what I mean by that? A caretaker comes in and takes care of things. You want to, you know, you steward it, you use it and everything, whatever, but it's not ultimately yours. That's how it is with everything in life for us. Okay, but I'm going to kind of respect a little of our time. Secondly, I said that I'd break this up into 2 points. One, persevere with Jesus, and we saw 4 aspects of that. Now, persevere under leadership, and there's 8 aspects of this. That's like, you're like, man, 4 took an hour, 8's gonna take 3 hours. Okay, no, there's only 2 sentences on this. So, persevere under leadership. First of all, the church has leaders with authority. Before we go any further, recognize that the church has leaders, and leaders have authority. So, I'm not going to go any farther than just where the text takes us today. I'm not going to do a whole, because like I said, if it wasn't Christmas season, we could break this up into 4 sections, and one of them could be just on leadership, and then we could look at the broad scope of what Scripture says about leadership and all that. I'm not seeking to do that today. I'm just seeking to make the point he's making. But first of all, I need to recognize that the leaders in this church, Aragon and myself, there is authority. There's supposed to be authority attached to that. And then you can detail out how that's dispersed, and so I understand. But just recognize that churches have leaders and they have authority. But the bigger point being made here is going to be the second one. The shepherding of your soul is the central job description of church leadership. And that, listen, is to be recognized by every person in the church. Let's look at the text. Verse 17. Now mine says, have confidence. Most translations say obey. But I'll read what mine says. Have confidence in your leaders and submit to their authority, because they keep watch over you as those who must give an account. Now implicitly there, I think the expectation is that leaders recognize that they are there to serve the church. They're there. Leaders are here in order for the well-being of you, not for themselves. We're not CEOs or the top of a pyramid scheme or something like that. This is not a self-serving position. This is a people-serving position. But that's to be recognized by leaders, but it's also to be recognized by those in the church. Because it says, do this so that their work will be a joy, not a burden, for that would be of no benefit to you. You need to recognize that the job description of me and Aragon is to bring you through the finish line of faith boldly, to finish strong. And so every decision, every effort, every prayer, every ministry, every Bible study, every bit of assistance that we give is with that end in mind. And we need to keep that in the forefront of our mind as leaders, and you need to keep that in the forefront of your mind as congregants. And that, and I said I'm just going to, you know, just make this one point from this passage, because that's all he's really getting at. And so I'll say this. That needs to be your guiding principle in regards to leadership in any church. When it comes to hiring on a new pastor, this needs to be on your mind. That does this potential elder recognize that he's serving our church? Not our wants and selfish desires, but our spiritual needs in order to bring us through the finish line. Is he equipped in his doctrine? Does he have sound doctrine? Does he have an example that can be set, that can be followed? Things like that. And when that's recognized, when it's recognized that the shepherding of your soul is what our job is, well, what one of the things that can do is cause you to decide whether or not you're going to comply with that. If I approach you with something that, with some correction or encouragement or ministry opportunity or whatever, hopefully the first assumption is that my intention is to shepherd your soul toward maturity, toward faithfulness to the Lord long term. This ministry that a leader volunteers for, or is actually, I guess, anointed to, is work. And it might be a joy. The might is dependent upon you. That's what he says. Do this, do what? Obey and submit to the authority of the leaders in the church, so that their work will be a joy and not a burden. Now, it's work either way. I mean, we're called to do this, and I'm gonna have to give an account regardless. But it's up to you whether it's going to be a joyous experience or not. Let me just give a brief list of what leaders do. Leaders are to pray for you. They're to assist you, even with physical needs. In whatever way we can, that's going to enable you to be faithful to the Lord. We are to defend you. That is, physically and spiritually. Explicitly in Scripture, it says that an elder is to be able to discern between true and false doctrine and weed out the false doctrine and warn the church and mark false teachers and things like that. It may turn out someday that on a Sunday morning or maybe in Sunday school, the content will be, listen, here's this false teaching, and we do this in Sunday school sometimes, that some churches are teaching, and we want you to be aware of that. Why? So we can fill an hour that we have to fill every week? No. But because that's another thing, that it's just another way of shepherding the flock. By defending the flock. Leaders believe in the flock. They believe in you. Love hopes all things, endures all things. Listen to what this guy, I love the fact that this guy says a lot about exhorting one another, and he says at the end of this is that even this letter is an exhortation. Leaders believe in the congregation. So listen to this real quick. He says in chapter 5, verse 11, we have much to say about this topic he just introduced, but it's hard to make it clear to you because you no longer try to understand. In fact, though by this time you should be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. That's a harsh word. He says you should be further than this. I shouldn't have to explain elementary things, and I'd like to teach you even more, but I can't get you there yet. But listen to what he says later. He says, look, let's move beyond the elementary teachings about Christ and be taken forward to maturity. Here is a leader to his congregation saying, Come on. Come on. You should be farther than this. Let's go. Not laying again the foundation of repentance from acts that lead to death and of faith in God, instruction about cleansing rites, the laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, eternal judgment. He says, let's move beyond all that. You guys should be, you know, maturing. And he wants to get into talking about Melchizedek and how Jesus is a priest. But listen to this. And God permitting, we will do so. He gives this long warning. I'm going to skip it just for sake of time. But he gives this long warning about if you have come to the point where you've heard a lot of this, but you haven't internalized it and believed it, you're not even up the fold at all. And it may be so that you become so hard-hearted you can never turn back. But then he says, even though we speak like this, with these warnings and severe corrections and everything, dear friends, we are convinced of better things in your case. The things that have to do with salvation. This is the kind of disposition that leaders ought to have toward those toward their church members, is a hopefulness. We believe in you, that God is working in you. And we're operating on that assumption, on that belief. Anyway, I was trying to just read this list. So leaders pray for the flock, they assist the flock, they defend the flock, they believe in the flock, they fetch the flock when they go astray, they sympathize with the flock when they're struggling, when they're weak and lame, they command the flock when they need to be commanded, they are accountable to the flock, they correct the flock, they continue in patience with the flock, they support the flock, they remind the flock, like the leader does here when he reminds them of the people who came and preached the word to them in the first place. These are things that the leader does, and it's all for that one day when Paul says about the Thessalonians and he says about the Corinthians also, that they will be his joy in the next life. That he'll be able to present them to the Lord. That's what he's worried about. That's what the goal is. And so as long as we keep that in mind, as long as you keep that in mind, a lot of the relational conflict can be resolved a lot better when we know that our intention is your maturity. And if you have a mindset, one last word on this, if you have a mindset that, listen, I can take care of myself, I don't need the help of some shepherd, you know, shepherding my soul, that self-sufficiency will get you killed. That self-sufficiency will get you spiritually killed. And that's not hyperbole. I'm speaking to the pride that is inextricably linked with that mindset, of which God hates. We need others. And this is not to say also that Aragon and I are shepherds and therefore we have no accountability. And we're believers first. And so there's some mutual accountability there. But that's enough for now. So summary. Persevere in faith as did those before us. Persevere in faith, not tampering with the message we've been given. Persevere in faith no matter what it costs. Persevere in faith remembering what you've been given and promised. And persevere in faith by recognizing the guardians that God has put in your life to help you do so. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thanks for your word again. Thank you for the people you put in our life, all the church members that are here. Thank you for the leaders that are here. Thank you for the fact that you're building your church and that you are the great shepherd. Thank you that you're the one who is going to ensure our safe entry, our safe transition from this life into the next. I pray that that would captivate my thinking more and more, and the thinking of everyone here more and more, so that we would look forward to the day, hasten the day that the Lord would return. This is not our home. I pray, God, that you would fill us with joy, fill us with the contentment that just automatically comes when we recognize we're sons and daughters of you, and embolden us in our faith so that we would confidently identify ourselves with the Lord Jesus, even in his reproach. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Amen.